war economy, the military-industrial complex, which many people translate to the term empire, has its tentacles in everything in the United States.
The U.S. war economy, from the past to the present. The new enemy, ISIL.
Yeah, I think we're looking at kind of a 30-year war.
A permanent state of war, a war economy, to an enemy that at times no one sees, but ones that are manufactured. Hi, I'm Kavit Tahwi. This program and the next one is all about the permanent war economy of the United States. Arms trade is big business. The U.S. arms manufacturer's stocks are booming, and new enemies have been manufactured. Stay tuned as we dive into profits from death and destruction created by the war profiteers. The U.S. military industry, a business that manufactures weapons, military technology, and equipment. How big an industry? Well, it's estimated that the U.S. spends over $1.5 trillion yearly. That's 2.7% of the world GDP. Why does the U.S. spend so much on its military? You'd be surprised. It's called the permanent war economy. U.S. politicians, their foreign policy, its economy is based on this. The U.S. needs to always be in a permanent state of war, or the threat of one or more wars at the same time. Our starting point this week, the year 1944, where the origin of this concept of permanent war took shape.
The Great Depression was a bitter and long-lasting event, and it shook the core beliefs about the way that the U.S. economy worked. The United States had spent a decade in an economic crisis, far longer than the recessions that had come previously. Americans, from its citizens to intellectuals and policymakers, began to think that capitalism had failed them. It appeared that nothing was lifting the economy from its slump. Then came World War II. And almost as quickly, the narrative arose that war-related work could solve the problem of unemployment on an ongoing business. War equals good business. War had made businesses boom and brought economic opportunity, better living, and money in the bank to almost all who participated in it. It showed Americans at the time that the economy could produce guns, that military spending could boost the economy, and that war could be used to create employment. The character of a war economy had taken shape. Better yet, it was concluded that even in peacetime, U.S. military expenditure should remain large to reduce the percentage of the unemployed. Hence, a war economy was born, driven by military manufacturers, but not without consequences, as reflected in a warning by then U.S. President Dwight Eisenhower.
Disarmament is a continuing imperative. I confess that I laid down my official responsibilities in this field with a definite sense of disappointment.
But to no avail. In 1944, the CEO of GE, General Electric, and Vice Chairman of the War Production Board, Charles Edward Wilson, argued for the continuation of large-scale military spending and institutionalized war economy to be directed by corporate executives and funded by the government. GE did have products for conventional use, but Wilson's economic argument was for military applications. He stated that there was an economic component within the military-industrial complex, a collusion between militarism and war profiteering to manifest itself permanently, subsidized by the U.S. government.
Others followed, like General Motors GM in Detroit Industries' unveiling of its 1944 model airplanes.
This on air-mindedness. Crowds pack jam the show every day. Most of the old favorites of the days before gasoline rationing are here. Today, they're displaying machines of war in place of straight eights and convertible coupes with white sidewall tires.
The writing was on the wall. The U.S. would not return to a civilian economy, but from this point on would keep to a permanent war economy.
General Electric is a big war profiteer, and they have their hands in the media. So we can see the media collaborates with the Pentagon and the war machine and the defense industries to help keep the citizens of the U.S. afraid of the enemy du jour, which today seems to be ISIS or ISIL.
The first question is, why does the U.S. resort to a permanent war economy? And, I think it comes down to, the military-industrial complex, basically, that, we've got this situation where, ever since World War II, we've been dependent on an arms industry as our major export.
This is a tradition that goes back a century. If you look at what the time period of World War I, when Woodrow Wilson wanted to mobilize the U.S. population to get behind the U.S. entering the war, he called upon a man named Edward Bernays, who was Sigmund Freud's nephew, to put together a public relations campaign. And a crude example of what he did was people weren't even allowed to use the phrase sauerkraut because the Germans were the enemy. They called it liberty cabbage. And so this is a 100 years in the making, this type of propaganda. And so the new evildoers that get added to the rogues gallery roughly once or twice a year, and the people in power are happy for us to focus on these new villains as opposed to a bigger picture of, like I said, social, economic, and environmental collapse. So it's far more than a notion. It's a very, very clear-cut practice to keep us distracted.
War economy, the military-industrial complex, which many people translate to the term empire, has its tentacles in everything in the United States. People's pensions are invested in companies that profit off of war. The war machine, the war profiteers, they donate or give grants to colleges and universities. So it's even in that part of our economy.
These arms manufacturers would not exist if their products would not be used. So there has to be a reason for their use and even existence, either a threat to U.S. national security, or better yet, an actual war.
U.S. permanent war economy equals the need for constant war, or the threat of one, be it manufactured, to justify the tax dollars being spent on it. The shocking part, the extent of U.S. military engagement, a process which began decades ago. The Cold War. One of the most beneficial gifts to the arms industry was the threat from the Soviet Union, which gave rise to the Cold War. The Cold War was not an actual armed conflict. It was based on threats. The big weapons were nuclear arms, hence the arms race. Sputnik, Russia's satellite, the first in space, was used for research of ICBMs, intercontinental ballistic missiles. The weapons of the United States consisted of nuclear submarines, cruise missiles, nuclear payloads, and advanced aircrafts. And at the end, not a nuclear shot was fired. All that was fired up was the money that was spent on it. Looking at the total cost of the Cold War from the year 1948 through 1991, a staggering $13.1 trillion. The average annual military spending during the Cold War, $298.5 billion. Manufactured Iran threat.
An Iranian nuclear weapon is one of the most frightening things we have to confront.
Call a nuclear-armed Iran the greatest danger to world peace.
Another manufactured threat, if there was ever one, was the supposed nuclear threat of the Islamic Republic of Iran, a country which, unlike the U.S., had not attacked another country in over 100 years, an accusation which has been backed by lies and aptly titled by investigative journalist, reporter, and author Gareth Porter, Manufactured Crisis, the untold story of the Iran nuclear scare.
Where's Iran? Iran's completed the first stage. Took them many years, but they completed it, and they're 70% of the way there. Now they're well into the second stage. And by next spring, at most, by next summer, at current enrichment rates, they will have finished the medium enrichment and move on to the final stage. From there, it's only a few months, possibly a few weeks, before they get enough enriched uranium for the first bomb. So if these are the facts, if these are the facts, and they are, where should a red line be drawn? A red line should be drawn right here. Before Iran completes the second stage of nuclear enrichment.
The point I want to make is that the documents clearly were manufactured, fabricated by an ally of the MEK, not the MEK itself. And that ally could only have been Israel.
The U.S. went to the bank with this manufactured crisis.
Took an important first step toward a comprehensive solution that addresses our concerns with the Islamic Republic of Iran's nuclear program.
The Middle East, U.S.'s ideal customer in this perceived threat.
This entry by Israel's Haaretz sums up U.S. military sales. U.S. tripled weapon sales in 2011 to counter Iran's threats based on a study. The study said that U.S. worked out policy goal with Arab allies in the Persian Gulf to build a regional missile defense system to protect cities, oil refineries, pipelines, and military bases from possible Iranian military attack.
Which brings us to Israel. Despite the sale of these weapons to Middle Eastern nations, the United States has always maintained that it will continue to guarantee Israel's qualitative military edge over Arab nations, simultaneously drumming up the Iran threat. Little did these countries know that the U.S. would push for engagement with Iran on a historic nuclear agreement. Wonder if they would have purchased these military equipment had they known. 9/11. The impact of 9/11 on business and economics. The business of terror. The day that changed everything. The decade following the terrorist attacks of 9/11 was a heady time for U.S. spending.
This was Forbes' take. 16 ways 9/11 changed the way Americans did business. We looked at the top five. It has helped Americans to compete. Employee assistance programs have expanded. It reminded Americans that doing well also meant doing good. It gave a wake-up call to entrepreneurs. And it confirmed that cash was king, meaning savings in the bank.
A snapshot of U.S. spending since September 11, 2001 would shock you. $7.6 trillion had been spent on the military and homeland security since 9/11. The Pentagon's base budget increased by 81% during that time. And if you think the threat from terrorists is winding down, think again. We got four letters for you. ISIL, the War on Terrorism, an endless war. Long before Americans were introduced to the new 9/11 era supervillains called ISIL, or ISIS, senior Obama officials were openly and explicitly stating that America's war on terror, already 12 years old, would last at least another decade. In late 2012, the Washington Post reported that there was no clear end in sight. That timeline suggested that the United States had reached only the midpoint of what was once known as the global war on terrorism. In May 2013, the Senate Armed Services Committee held a hearing on whether it should revise the 2001 authorization to use military force.
But I have one significant point of disagreement that I want to spend some time on, and that is the question of whether the president has the authority without additional congressional authorization to carry out the mission as described. Secretary Hagel, you have used the phrase war against ISIL today, and others in the administration have used that phrase. And General Dempsey, you have talked about a multi-year effort, and others in the administration have expressed the same concern. And I believe very strongly, and I don't think this is just a theoretical or law professor argument, that the president does need the authority of Congress to conduct the mission that he described and you've discussed today.
Gentlemen, I've only been here 5 months, but this is the most astounding and most astoundingly disturbing hearing that I've been to since I've been here. You guys have essentially rewritten the Constitution here today. The Constitution, Article 1, Section 8, Clause 11, clearly says that the Congress has the power to declare war. This authorization, the AUMF, is very limited. And you keep using the term associated forces. You use it 13 times in your statement. That is not in the AUMF. And you said at one point, it suits us very well. I assume it does suit you very well because you're reading it to cover everything and anything. And then you said at another point, so if even if the AUMF doesn't apply, the general law of war applies, and we can take these actions. So my question is, how do you possibly square this with the requirement that of the Constitution that the Congress has the power to declare war? This is one of the most fundamental divisions in our constitutional scheme, that the Congress has the power to declare war, the President is the Commander-in-Chief and prosecutes the war. But you're reading this AUMF in such a way as to apply clearly outside of what it says.
A committee member asked a senior Pentagon official, Assistant Secretary Michael Sheehan, how long the war on terror would last. His reply, at least 10 to 20 years.
Even though I'd caveat that quickly by saying, number one, we have a long way to go. Number two, it's notwithstanding many of the errors and mistakes we've made since 9/11.
Welcome to America's 30-year war, one which, by the Obama administration's own reasoning, has no geographic limit.
The Guardian reported Washington gets explicit. This war on terror is permanent. Senior Obama officials told the U.S. Senate that the war, in limitless form, will continue to last for at least another decade or two.
Not only are we spending these trillions of unnecessary dollars every year, our human resources are being wasted. My own son's life was taken by this permanent war. We have a permanent war economy because we're in permanent war. And then millions of people around the world are killed, tortured, their lives destroyed, or oppressed because of the U.S. empire and all of our bases and evil tentacles all over the world. I believe that the war economy, the Pentagon, the war profiteers, the wars, everything, they're literally sucking the life out of our communities and out of our countries.
And the enemy is? Former Bush Department of Justice lawyer Jack Goldsmith had said that nobody even knows against whom this endless war is being waged. Amazingly, there's a very large question, even in the Armed Services Committee, about who the U.S. is at war against and where and how those determinations are made, is what Jack Goldman said. If there are any questions to the endless war doctrine, it was answered recently by comments from two leading Democrats. Leon Panetta, who served as Obama's defense secretary and CIA director, said, I think we're looking at a kind of 30-year war.
I mean, the reality is that 9/11, we went to war against al-Qaeda, who attacked this country. ISIS, you know, may not be al-Qaeda, but they represent the fanaticism. It's only a matter of time before they will then use it as a basis on which to attack this country. Yeah, I think we're looking at kind of a 30-year war. History here.
Yes, the U.S., it's been obvious, especially since the Cold War, that that the government and the media, the corporate propaganda media, works together to manufacture these enemies. And, it was the communists, it was al-Qaeda. Now it's ISIS, and the U.S. has already spent $1 billion fighting ISIS. When I can't find out how much money that the U.S. spent arming and training ISIS when they were attached with the Free Syrian Army. So obviously it's manufacturing enemies to keep the war machine going. And there's been so many times, often, where the U.S. is arming both sides of a conflict. And I know, for example, during the Iran-Iraq war, the U.S. was arming both sides of the conflict. And I often have to wonder if my own son, Casey, was killed in 2004 in Iraq by a weapon that the U.S. sold to Saddam Hussein.
It's part of a cycle. It's not the first time that someone in power has talked about decades to, quote unquote, end a war. Both parties sort of play along in this game. But if you look at the actual accounting, every year, roughly between 49% and 54% of federal tax dollars goes to the Department of so-called Defense. So the numbers don't fluctuate as much as they would like us to believe. And it's just a matter of who's in charge of the propaganda. As I like to say, the primary difference between the Republicans and Democrats is they just tell different lies to get elected and different lies to stay in office.
Then we have Hillary Clinton, whom Panetta gushed would make a great president. She left no doubt about her intentions, endless war forever, as noted in the following. Key Democrats, led by Hillary Clinton, leave no doubt that endless war is official U.S. doctrine. Maybe she said that knowing the answer to the question which was cited in the dissenter. The United States is fighting how many wars? Today, the U.S. military operations are involved in scores of countries across all five continents, said the dissenter. Citing a page at U.S. Central Command's CENTCOM website, the U.S. is active in 20 countries in the Middle East. And U.S. Africa Command, or AFRICOM, stated that the U.S. has relationships with 54 nations, for a grand total of 74 nations.
You can make an argument that it's been a state of permanent war, at least since the end of World War II. And what's simultaneously happened at that time was the advent of television and greater forms of technology to advance this public relations and this programming. We're winding down the war in Iraq and Afghanistan while engaging in 74 countries across the globe, fully confident that the vast majority of Americans will just take it at face value and move on to the next story because they've been so heavily conditioned for over a century.
74 nations the U.S. is fighting or helping, some force in some proxy struggle that has been deemed beneficial by the nation's masters of war. If there were any questions, it was laid to rest by the independent journalist Jeremy Scahill in his movie Dirty Wars, leaving no doubt about U.S. covert engagement in countless wars.
What we have essentially done is created one hell of a hammer. And for the rest of our generation, this force will be continually searching for an end.
Despite whatever conspiratorial theories, there's nothing to it.
The list of raids read like a map of a hidden war. Algeria, Indonesia, Thailand, Jordan.
I mean, I think these operations are happening in several dozen countries. You know, there are U.S. Special Operations Forces deployed in 75 to 100 countries around the world on any given day. And, you know, a lot of what they're doing is working with other countries' militaries, doing training exercises. But the cases that I think are really important for us to focus on is when they're involved with what was called kinetic operations and unilateral operations. In other words, when they're doing targeted kill operations or they're doing snatch and grab operations in countries outside of the declared battlefield of Afghanistan. And you know, so what the U.S. is doing in Somalia right now is effectively outsourcing the kill program to these warlords, some of whom had been allies of al-Qaeda in a previous lifetime, and they're now running around with these kill lists and, you know, a band of men hunting down people, in some cases names that the Americans have given them, in other cases people they just suspect of being Islamic radicals.
That does it for part one of U.S. War Profiteers. Do join us for the second part, where we'll discuss the lobbying and the congressmen, Wall Street profits, and civilian applications from the battlefield. I'm Kavitha Avoyi, and I'll see you next week.